Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Online sales available now at Sunbury Motors. Great staff, great product line, great deals. And the service department open Monday through Friday, 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. Play-by-play call of the day, MJ over Chris Elo.
Sellers has Jordan. Jordan with 2 seconds to go puts it up and scores at the buzzer. Michael Jordan has won it for Chicago. Michael Jordan hit the basket at the buzzer.
Yep, he sure did. And that was one of the signature moments early in the MJ career. No doubt about that. I was one of those get over the hump, end of the game, he's got it moments. And to his credit, he had it. So, yeah, Michael Jordan. All right. Let's bring in Mike Conti now from Atlanta. Mike, welcome. It is great to have you with us. I hope you and yours are safe down there in Georgia.
Thank you, Steve. We are, and I hope you and your family are as well.
Thank you, Mike. Appreciate that. So Georgia is going through, I guess I can label it a soft opening. Would that be fair? How have I'll start with that, then we'll get to the Hawks. How's that progressed so far?
It's been controversial, and I think a lot of people, and this kind of applies to our NBA discussion, I think a lot of people are still a little bit hesitant to go out and reopen their business or get back to life the way we knew it back in March, in early March. Georgia did not really have a very strict stay-at-home policy in the same way that Pennsylvania does. There wasn't this mass closure of non-essential businesses the same way that, it was in Pennsylvania. But the governor of Georgia did implement a brief, I think 2 or 3 week long, stay-at-home advisory where he required hair salons, tattoo parlors, bowling alleys, gyms, and a couple other businesses to close temporarily. He eliminated dine-in restaurants. You were still allowed to get carry-out, but you couldn't eat inside. Basically, what Governor Kemp did was he took those very few businesses that he ordered to close temporarily and basically gave them the green light and said, the state's not going to keep you from opening anymore. So that's where we stand right now. It was a relaxation of a segment of a government advisory. But as I think we're going to get into here, Steve, it's created some questions now for a lot of NBA players who live in Atlanta. They don't necessarily play for the Hawks, but they live in Atlanta. Who were inquiring with their teams, okay, well, if LA Fitness is open or if 24-hour Fitness is open, can we go there and play pickup games? And the league did not want that happening. So that's where we kind of stand right now. In many cases, those gyms still aren't reopening because they want to wait. They want to, I guess, get a better handle on what the best practices are for them to operate in this this pandemic new normal. I hate that phrase, but new normal that we're in right now. And there's been a lot of hesitation from segments of the business community, even though they are legally allowed to open, to actually go ahead and do it.
All right, so let's now get into, you know, it was going to be May 1st. The NBA had indicated maybe they would think about reopening some facilities. Now they've pushed it back to May 8th. How do the Hawks feel about the May 8th, since it is 2 weeks away? Is this one of those, let's see how everything goes for the next 10 days in Georgia, if we're comfortable, we'll do it?
I think they feel better about it than if it were to be May 1st. Travis Schlenk, the Hawks general manager, said that they were not going to open this Friday. There are only two teams in the league that would not have had stay-at-home orders in effect this coming Friday that would have allowed their practice facilities to open, the Atlanta Hawks and the Oklahoma City Thunder. That's it. So only two of the 30 clubs in the league would have been able to do this in the first place. Travis Schlenk, the Hawks general manager, said they did not want to do that. They wanted to see what was going to happen to the numbers in Georgia, if there'd be a resurgence in cases, a spike in cases, as some of these businesses do reopen. In other words, they didn't want to do anything until it was safe. And I think it's important to point out, too, that what was reported over the weekend about May 1st, in all likelihood, was a trial balloon.
Sure.
I think we've seen this a little bit in the reporting about Major League Baseball starting back up. I think it was a trial balloon that was not received warmly anywhere. And in one of the two markets that would have been affected by it, it wasn't received warmly here. And that's likely why the league has backed it up another week to May the 8th.
What's interesting, because the Braves, now they play in, it sounds like Arizona and Florida is where they play, but the Braves ballpark is not in downtown Atlanta.
It's not, correct.
Right. It's not exactly what you'd say in a small populated area either.
Well, but you know, I don't know what Major League Baseball is going to do. The Braves are owned by Liberty Media, so it's not like they have a singular figurehead owner, but a representative of Liberty Media said last week that Major League Baseball is talking about doing some things that the public doesn't even know about. In reality, Atlanta could very easily be one of these sites where Major League Baseball plays these doubleheaders daily, because the Braves Stadium, Steve, and I'm sure you probably already know this, there is a 400-room hotel attached to the stadium.
Right, exactly.
And they're constructing another 300-room hotel on the stadium footprint. So if the goal is to kind of sequester these teams, I know that's a phrase that's been used, Atlanta is actually kind of well-positioned for this, because on-site, on the stadium footprint, they have multiple hotels, multiple restaurants, and multiple other businesses that would support the day-to-day operation of however many teams would be based there. Now, I have not heard down here any proposal, at least spoken out loud, that Atlanta would be a part of this reopening plan for Major League Baseball. But I think it would make a lot of sense, and that's why I think you've seen this movement from, well, everything just in Arizona to now Ken Rosenthal reporting today. It could be 10 or 12 or even 20 different sites across the league that could be used once things start getting up and running.
What about the NBA thought? Is the thought going to look? It sounds like they don't have everything fully baked here.
No,
but could they possibly, for example, use Phillips Arena? Could they possibly? Are these possibilities?
I think anything is on the table. And anything is possible. Adam Silver has said he's instructed his staff to come to him with any ideas. I think it's more likely, Steve, that games will be played in practice facilities.
Yeah,
I really believe that.
That makes sense. That makes sense. That's essentially what they do with the summer league anyway.
Exactly. If you watch the Orlando, basically anything outside of what they do in Las Vegas and Salt Lake City, if you watch the Orlando summer league, they play at the Magic's facility.
That's right.
What I have been told, Steve, is that the NBA is discussing a plan where if they can ever get back, they would limit the number of people in the building to 35. It would be the two teams, coaches, athletic trainers, managers, three referees, three scorekeepers. That's it. Broadcasters from studio. Cameras would be operated robotically. It would be very, very minimal. At least this is one of the ideas that's being floated. Well, if that's the case, I mean, you could play at the YMCA on Whitehall Road. you just need a floor and two hoops, basically.
Okay, now look, don't get them too excited that suddenly LeBron's going to show up, okay?
Well, maybe we'll go to State High instead. We'll use the North Building, Jim. I don't know. But that's all you would need. You don't necessarily need to have the arenas in play. But, I mean, I've heard a bunch of things. I've heard Disney World's been thrown out there. I was told I was told the Vegas thing was actually a rumor that may have been started by a casino in Las Vegas, and that the league has not really talked about that. So also, a lot more flexibility with the NBA, I think, Steve.
Yeah, and Disney would be the Y World of Disney complex,
right,
is what they're talking about. Penn State's played there before in the tournament. And that's fine. That's a fine complex. In fact, I think for a long time the Braves training facility was next door to it.
Yes, exactly, until this past year when they moved to Northport. Right.
Yep. So I'll say this about Vegas. You and I both know a lot of those places have arenas.
They do.
I mean, there have to be within, I don't know, 5 square miles? Five or six arenas. Like Mandalay Bay has one, MGM has one, Orleans has one. Obviously, T-Mobile is, you know, I mean, it's not like they don't have access. They got like 5 of them there.
Well, and you know, when the NBA went to India, when Vivek Rendive took the Sacramento Kings to India in late September to play in the preseason, they played that game in a hotel ballroom.
They've done that too, Cancun.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Exactly. And the Battle of Atlantis, I think, is done the same way. So I think the long story short is this, Steve. The NBA's got a lot of options. There are a lot of different possibilities, but they're also racing against the clock.
Sure.
And they're going to get to a point pretty soon. I want to point out, I don't think May 8th and having training facilities reopen for individual workouts is any indication that the league is close to restarting. But the league is going to have to make some plans or some kind of decision fairly soon, because if they want to start the 2020-21 season...
That's going to be my question. Exactly. How close do you end one and start the other one?
Right. Labor Day would probably have to be the drop-dead day for the end of the NBA Finals. And what I've been told, Steve, is if the league is going to restart, players are going to need 2 weeks where they can work in small groups individually, and then another 2 weeks where they can play 5-on-5.
That's logical.
So you're talking about a 4-week lead-up to even resuming regular season games. And if you look at the current regular season standings in both conferences, I don't think a ninth-place team is closer than 3 games back of eighth right now.
I know.
So you really could call it good and say we're going to go straight to the playoffs, but then you have the issue of the players who are, starting May 1st, going to have 25% taken out of their checks. They want to play. I work for an NBA team. I want to work. I work for a team that's not going to the playoffs.
Right.
I would really like to have those 16 games, but it might not be up to me.
Right.
So I think that's one of the things that's going to be on the table, Steve, is it worth it to even resume the regular season, or do you go straight ahead to the postseason and just try to play it out that way?
What does that – let's get to the media part for just a moment. What would it mean to the TV network that covers – the regional network that covers the Hawks? What would it mean to the radio network just to get back and doing games? I mean, I'm talking about from an advertising financial point of view.
Yeah, well, I think our listeners would enjoy the content.
yes, oh, I know they would. Yeah,
I hope they would. But you're right. I mean, you have advertisers that you need to make whole. You have affiliates that you need to make whole. I don't know contractually if there's a force majeure clause or an act of God clause or anything like that. But the same thing applies for the national TV broadcasters, who do provide a substantial amount of revenue to the league. They're going to ask for rebates if they can't show a playoff. And they stand to lose not tens of millions of dollars, hundreds of millions of dollars could be lost by Disney and Turner with the lack of advertising revenue that would be associated with the NBA playoffs. So there is a real desire to play. This isn't like everyone's just kind of sitting around, you know, kind of passing the time, and if it happens, it happens. There's a real urgency to get back to play, but above anything else, the NBA wants to do everything safely, and they're not going to do anything until they feel like it is safe to do so.
Who has more power in this, the owners or the Players Association?
The owners. The Players Association are obviously, it's very, very important to them, too. And they'll have a say. There's no question about it. But I think, and Major League Soccer is kind of in the same boat too. I do Atlanta United matches on the radio, Steve. And you know, Major League Soccer and its players union right now are in negotiations about what could be if reports are to be believed, substantial pay cuts for players who make more than $100,000 in the event that, games are canceled.
Right.
Major League Soccer is in a little bit of a different boat than, say, the NBA, where it's a little bit more of a battle for long-term survival for that league. But you don't necessarily have this acrimonious negotiation between owners and players this time. It's not like there's a threat of a work stoppage or a CBA is expiring. Everyone has the same goal.
Right.
They're trying to monetize what little can be monetized here, and it needs to be done fairly. And I think in the case of the NBA, the negotiations will probably be conducted in good faith. I'd be surprised otherwise. But I will tell you, Steve, that there are a lot of owners who are very, very concerned about restarting play too soon. And I think Mark Cuban has yeah. vocalized that, among others. There are many players who are chomping at the bit to get back and play right now,
yep.
which is why this whole training moratorium could expire on May 8th, because the league's trying to find safe ways for these players to train. So it's unusual. I mean, you would right. think it might be the reverse, where the owners right. really, really want to get back and the players don't. And in some cases, it might be the reverse in the case of the NBA.
Last question. Taiwan and South Korea both started playing baseball again. Mm-hmm. And so far, so good. All right. So far, so good. How important is it for a league, not necessarily the NBA, a league to start and to have some
vital
success.
Vital. Someone's got to go first.
Yeah.
And I think that's where we're at right now, Steve. This is my opinion. It's not based on any reporting. It's not based on anything that anyone has
right.
told me.
Right.
In my opinion, I feel like everyone's afraid to go first. And that's why I applaud the PGA Tour for at least having a plan. And it's going to be with fans, not in attendance, but at least having a plan to get started in about 5 weeks. Someone's got to go first and prove that it works.
Yeah.
I think in a soccer standpoint, what they're doing in Germany is going to be very, very critical in the next
yeah.
couple weeks. Their teams
Good
are
point.
Already training. They're pinpointing May 9th as a date to resume play.
Right.
But I think, Steve, once someone starts back up and can show that it can be done safely,
mm-hmm.
Then you're going to have everyone else falling in line in yeah. pretty fast order, I would think, to join them, because there's a lot of money on the table, and if it can be proven to be done safely, I think there's incentive for them to get to work.
Yeah, I sent the governor of Pennsylvania a video of me playing golf, and where he saw the places I was hitting the ball.
And look what happened.
I mean, he said, man, that dude automatically social distancing. Okay, let him back.
Right. We've been lucky here in Georgia. They never closed the golf courses. That has been, in fact, the golf courses have been packed down here, as you can imagine. So, and I'm sure this weekend in Pennsylvania, it'll be the same.
Mike, all my best to you, my friend. And I can't wait to sit down and break bread soon.
Me too, Steve. I hope it'll be sooner rather than later. And all my best to you and yours up there.
Mike Conti joining us from Atlanta. By the way, Ken Rosenthal, wide-ranging report in The Athletic. Most realistic time range for opening day of Major League Baseball is somewhere between mid-June and the 4th of July. In the view of most officials, it would allow for an 80 to 100 game regular season, with the schedule running through October. An expanded postseason at neutral sites might follow, with the World Series ending in late November or in early December, when it says here in the report that Luke Cotrillo would be 11 months old. All right. There you go. Everything seems to be based on your child.
Well, that'd be a way to celebrate a World Series, NFL playoff push going. Oh, my, that's going to be busy.
Hey, you sitting there on the couch. Lisa's shaking her head. All right. We'll come back with more in a moment. Brought to you by Sunbury Motors on News Radio 1070 WKOK. When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way? The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years. All right, next half hour, Neal Coolong on the NFL Draft. Sal Palantonio coming up tomorrow. We'll also hear Phil Troutwine, Penn State's new offensive line coach, tomorrow as well. Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sunbury Motors back and rolling again with online sales. Great staff. They have great product lines and a lot of great deals and financing. So check it out online with Sunbury Motors. And also don't forget the Sunbury Motors Service Department, service parts, whatever, open Monday through Friday, 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. All at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Tomorrow, Sal Palantonio. And also tomorrow, we'll hear from new offensive line coach Phil Troutwine. So a lot going on in tomorrow's show as well. All right, so let's get to more on the Steelers draft. We've talked a lot about the Eagles draft, which Matt has just panned completely. Completely panned. Such a fan. You're such a fan guy. I'm worried that Luke made the Jalen Hurts pick. Imagine how that would turn out.
Oh, boy.
He'd be in timeout.
Then honestly, that would make more sense, but then, yeah, he would have been put in timeout.
With that, let's bring in Neal Coolong. Neal, welcome. Great to have you with us. I know I'm probably a free agent or an undrafted guy.
If there's an A, there's got to be an F. That's how the bell curve works.
So, look, the Steelers didn't have a first-round pick, but as we pointed out 1,000 times, they already had him. It's obviously Minka Fitzpatrick. When you look at what they did do based on the restraints they had without having a first-round pick, how well did they do?
I thought – I said this last year about their draft class as well, and it really ties into everything they did in the offseason. I think this was the draft class – they needed to get. I don't think it's one that is going to be the foundation of multiple championships in the future, but these are positions they needed to address, and they're players who fit, I think anyway, the upper echelon of what you would want from those positions. I think they need to get a starter to replace Bud Dupree. I don't think they expected Dupree to be around long-term. even if in the circumstances that they do work out some type of deal with him long term, they're going to need some depth at the position. I think Alex Hightower fits a lot of what they look for, and he's not a player I think that is going to get on the field defensively in an ideal situation a whole lot this year. I think he needs a little bit more work. Probably got to put on a bit of weight, and he could be the guy that they're looking to take over for Dupree in 2021. I think that's a smart pick. That's the type of player that you need to get. The second round pick I thought was the one that has the most upside, certainly, and it was probably not a position of critical importance for them in the next year unless it's some type of early warning response to contract negotiations with Juju Smith-Schuster. I've said this a couple times now. You look at the structure of Dallas's deal with Amari Cooper, it's going to be really hard for Juju to not want that kind of deal. And you're talking essentially $60 million guaranteed over 3 years of that contract. Right. Yeah, that's the kind of deal that they've give Roethlisberger. I don't know if they're giving that to a receiver.
Right.
But certainly I don't think Juju is in a position where he shouldn't ask for something along those lines, because I think he'll get it. I'm not sure if we've seen anything with this draft, it's the value of the wide receiver. I mean, there are some teams that did nothing but draft wide receivers.
It's
so
true.
You can see there's a market for it around the NFL, and Juju has shown he's a good one. Maybe a little bit of a down year this time around, but I don't think that's going to be the case this time next year, and I'm not entirely sure the Steelers aren't drafting Chase Claypool in an effort to replace that spot on the roster if they let Juju walk, if not tag him. I'm not sure where they would be in terms of an extension, but right now, after Cooper's contract, if I'm Juju, I'm not signing an extension if it's not something along those lines, and I don't think the Steelers would give him that right now, so... It could be in preparation for that, but I think a reasonable pick, probably not the one I expected them to go in the second round. But first two picks that they made are certainly they're defensible. You get where they're coming from,
sure.
And then they get
right.
a home run hitting back in the fourth round. That's probably the right spot, I think, for the player that they got. I think they got a pretty good one. We've seen that. A lot of explosion coming out of McFarland. I think he's the type of guy that it complements the stable of very similar backs that they already have.
Mm-hmm.
They can let one of them go now. They're probably going to do that. And they have some mm-hmm. Defense toward James Conner leaving next season as well. So it's the right types of players for where the team is right now and for next year.
Let me start with Claypool. Then I am going to get to McFarland. When it comes to Claypool, I think everybody's looking for, okay, what's this guy like? Devin Funchess started out his career at Michigan as a tight end because he played against Penn State. And then they moved him out to wide receiver. And then he ends up being a wide receiver in the NFL. And Funchess has been a good wide receiver. This guy's a lot like that, but, boy, I am concerned about – I would be concerned about any wideout that's carrying almost 240 pounds. And you watch him. He doesn't separate from good coverage. I mean, he just doesn't do it.
No, he really doesn't, and I those are legitimate concerns. And to cast the negative light on him, I'll say this: I teased the Ravens last year by taking a World War II battleship receiver in the third round, and the Steelers just took his counterpart the second.
That's
I'm not
true.
Sure if he's much better than what we saw of Miles Boykin.
Right.
I think a little bit.
I will say this about Claypool: at 6'4", almost 6'5", look, you know, that's a big target where, you know, and you know Ben throws to spots. That is a big target. So let's go with that plus. 4.42 is not a bad number in the 40 either. So.
Yeah, I think it's a great number. My concern is it doesn't seem like he runs that on the field.
Yes.
You know, and exactly what you said. He doesn't separate from good coverage. His athleticism alone, his long striding ability, and the fact that they only use them outside the numbers, he shouldn't have as many contested catches in college as he did. You know, everyone's going to say the quarterback this and that, blah, blah, blah. He should be a yard or two ahead of those guys. And I'll say this, it's very much me cherry-picking the example, but you look back on Martavis Bryant's college highlights. He wasn't making contested college catches because guys couldn't keep up with him.
Right.
He's running a legit 4.2. If he's that kind of speed translated onto the field, which, you know, you're not running that fast on the field in pads with your head moving around and everything, but I'm not seeing the translation of speed, I think, the same way that Mike Tomlin did. And Tomlin addressed that when he spoke. He basically said, you know, in drills in particular, this guy stood out in all of them. You see a lot of potential, and this is a coaching staff, even with a new position coach, that has a lot of experience being around the development of young athletic receivers and turning them into at least pretty solid pros. I won't write them off, but I will say that this pick is not nearly the plug and play that a lot of people seem to think that it is. I don't see him getting on the field right away. And if anything, it's an indictment against James Washington's ability to play the split end position. But at the same time, Claypool is only a split end. He can't do anything else. I don't see him running skinny posts, slants, those types of things that you kind of hope to get out of bigger receivers. I'm not sure he can do that.
Red zone fade, though. I mean, he's the kind of big target on a red zone fade you'd think about. McFarland is interesting. Obviously, I saw enough of him. McFarland, I think a lot of people try to compare him to Giovanni Bernard of the Bengals, and he was a first-round pick. This guy's a fourth-round pick. First of all, durability, not there. I don't think people realize that he played 23 games at Maryland, and only four of them did he have more than 14 carries in a game. All right? And people talk about, okay, his ability to catch the ball. All right, but he, unfortunately for him, and you can't change this, has a small catch radius.
Yeah, he's a little dude.
He's a kickoff return guy.
He is, in many ways, the future of the modern running back in the NFL. And I think they had the opportunity to draft guys I think would fit more of a three-down mold, which really they've done. They've tried to do. That's what James Conner has worked to become. That's a lot of what you see in Benny Snell. Maybe to some degree, maybe Jalen Samuels. They've tried to make Jalen Samuels into that.
Yeah.
McFarland is absolutely not a three-down back.
No.
And I don't think that's a bad thing. I do think that a pick like that
I agree with that, Neal. I agree with you. I think you can spot him in certain areas, and you know, maybe you can get him into the open field because, I mean, he's certainly quick.
Yeah, I think that's his biggest asset, and that's what they need. I mean, what they really do not have right now are running backs that can make guys miss. And I think you look at the physical makeup, you look at the speed, the athleticism. McFarland should be able to do that. He should be able to outmaneuver guys on the field in the open field. They're going to have to set him up. I don't think he's going to be able to do that between the tackles as well. But you get him the ball in space, and this is a passing offense. They have, you know, they're working in spread concepts. They're obviously very committed to having a lot of receivers. You hope that a single back out of shotgun can run a pattern or two out of that, get himself open, and make a guy miss. That's really, I think, where the home run threat is. That's where the speed is going to help him. And he has the makeup to be that kind of back. In the fourth round, especially considering what they've seen, what their philosophy seems to be in the fourth and fifth round, he's probably better than average that they would normally get in a draft.
Yeah,
I see where they're going with it.
Yeah, I'm fine with the fourth round because T just handed me a note. He reminds me of Dre Archer. I'm like, oh.
Isn't it funny, though? I mean, really, you brought up Giovanni Bernard. I haven't heard that one yet, but I've heard probably 17 different comparisons for this kid with an NFL player.
But I said, people have. I don't buy it. You know what I mean?
That's the thing. I'm not sure if he's anybody. That's why it's all over the place.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that he's that unique or that rare. I don't know if we know enough about him.
I think
you know?
he's maybe halfway between Giovanni Bernard and Dre Archer.
I'm not even sure if that's good or bad. Dre Archer. Oh, man.
He played against – Archer played against Penn State when he was at Kent State. I walked out there going – I looked at Jack and I said, what's the big deal about this kid? I don't see it.
One half of his body weighed twice as much as the other half, so he could never run straight. He had to angle everything that he did. I remember a kick return that he had against, like, Tennessee.
Oh,
I watched the all-22 angle of it from the end zone, and you see Archer. He takes the punt at the defensive, like, left hash, if not further over than the hash. He cut up a little bit, and then he went lateral the entire length of the field to get out of. He probably gained 5 yards on the kick return. And then the entire time in the picture,
you know what? I remember
you see
this
punter
play.
jogging. I mean, he's not even breaking a sweat, jogging, keeping up with him, just going right to the spot where he was going to go out of bounds. And the punter essentially forced him out of bounds,
right.
Didn't even touch him. Like, that personified Dre Archer to a T. And it just goes to show your vertical speed doesn't matter if you're not running vertically in the NFL.
Exactly.
This kid at least looks like he'll hit somebody. Archer wouldn't hit anybody if they paid him, and they tried for 3 years.
That is so true. I remember the play you're talking about. And you know what it reminded me of? It reminded me of the movie Major League when Willie Mays Hayes tries to steal second and he ends up by 5 feet short. The shortstop's like, come on, come on. And the punter's like, come on, just keep going. I'm right here.
that poor kid. You know, I enjoy pointing this out, the fact that Roosevelt Nix has more career combined yards rushing the ball than his college teammate Dre Archer does.
Yes.
And Nix was a college defensive tackle.
Yes.
So
it's
a bad memory. That's a bad memory.
Antoine Brooks out of Maryland can play some outside linebacker. He can play some safety. He did both at Maryland. He's not really a two-level player. He's probably one and a half, in my opinion. But in round six, did that seem like, hey, round six, let's give it a shot, see what we got here?
I expected them to draft the next evolution in the Morgan Burnett / Mark Barron tree that's going on in Pittsburgh. They want that hybrid linebacker safety position.
They are going to
take the beating that those two guys did.
They are going to chase.
They need to have that.
They are going to chase Troy Polamalu between now and the end of the Kevin Colbert thing.
Everybody is. Just, you know, some of them take the right player for it. And a lot of people I've seen have said, well, can Minka do that? It's like, you don't waste Minka Fitzpatrick on that.
Minka
Fitzpatrick is Ed Reed. You know, he's a single eye safety.
Yep.
A guy like Brooks, we'll see. You know, I'm not entirely sure a defense like this, if he's even going to make the team or he's not a practice squad guy. He certainly isn't somebody that another team is going to covet to put on their 53-man roster. So I will, as we sit right now, I'm just going to guess because they have some cap space left. There's still some moves they could make. We've talked about this before. I really don't see Jordan Berry making the team this year. So there's money that's going to be out there to sign a veteran safety. I think they need a backup. That's going to be something that they'll invest in if and when, you know, kind of the regular offseason activities get going here. They'll make a move to bring in a veteran safety to play a backup role. With that, I wouldn't see Brooks making the team barring injury or barring certain circumstances. I just don't know if they're really going to want to have, for the second year in a row, that hybrid type of player coming in to be a safety's body in a linebacker's role. I don't think they're going to want to do that again. That's just me. I don't think that they've gotten the results from that would justify trying a third time to do it. But Brooks is the guy that they would want to develop into that. Perfect fit in as far as that goes, but I'm not 100% convinced they know what they want that position to be, whatever it is that you call it. They've tried many times to fill it, and they've gotten bigger on it in terms of investment over the last couple of years. Keep in mind, you might remember way back when Robert Golden was an undrafted free agent who played safety and cornerback at Arizona. He stuck with them for a long time, a key special teams guy, but a key reserve safety. They wanted him to be kind of that combo guy as well. I think they've put in a lot of time and research in the past to develop that role of versatility to kind of match the slot receiver / tight end / H-back type of guy. I'm not sure if Brooks can be that, but I'm pretty sure that's the type of role they want him to fill. And I think that's probably going to include a year on the practice squad before they figure that out.
So let me just cut to the chase here. What you're saying, reading in between the lines of all of this that you and I have gone through, that it is essential that Ben Roethlisberger return healthy next year for the Steelers.
Yes.
I just want to make sure that after all this, that actually is the key to the whole season.
That the house of cards that are the Pittsburgh Steelers right now will come tumbling down if they don't get consistent quarterback play. And we saw that. Yeah. I mean, I remember joking around with you when they were 8-5. It's like, this is a great ride. You know, this is a lot of fun. But they're not far away from complete and total collapse. And then they blow their last three games and miss the playoffs. So
do you realize how much credibility you lost with the audience by your constant criticism of Duck Hodges?
Yes, I was informed by many people of that. It's a great story. Great kid. You love to see it. But they didn't even draft a quarterback, and he probably doesn't make the team. So
it's like, you gotta be kidding me. Like,
yeah.
It's like, I know
a lot of it was, I know you love him.
It's a great story. But Neil's right.
I think the best Duck Hodges moment was that that deep crosser he hit. I'm not sure if it was Juju or James Washington. The deep crosser he hit against the Bengals after – was it after Rudolph got yanked, or was it Rudolph that came in and made the throw? See, I don't even know anymore, and that's not a good thing.
No, it doesn't. Yeah,
but one of them, it was like the most simple throw they were going to make. They caught it. It was the right play call. It's a good play call. Safety wasn't behind him. It was just straight man coverage. I think it was Washington, who's quick. He's fast out of his breaks.
Yeah.
He was open by 5 yards. And a straight read by Hodges.
Come on.
Hit him between the numbers, and everyone's freaking out. This was the greatest thing ever. They finally gain yards against a Bengals team that was, I don't even care about who would hear me say this, but they're tanking their season if they started Ryan Finley. They wanted Joe Burrow that badly.
Yes.
They were going to – Andy Dalton is not Tom Brady, I know that, but there's no reason on that team to bench Andy Dalton for Ryan Finley.
That's right.
None whatsoever. And don't tell me you need to see what Ryan Finley is. He's a fifth-round rookie. You know what he is. You want to really know, look at the Pittsburgh Steelers. Look at who they're putting at quarterback. That's who Ryan Finley is. And fortunately, because of that deep dig, that 18-yard gainer on that play, that the Steelers were able to pull out the victory against the tough and feisty 1-15 Bengals or whatever they were. And people just went nuts over how great of a throw, how great of a read that was. It's like, oh, he's a professional. They're not even going to teach him to make that throw. He needs to make that in his sleep. I'm sorry, but yeah, Duck Hodges, poor kid. He's a nice guy. He's a professional. He came to work. He did his best. I'm not trying to rip him for that, but I hope it parlays him into a coaching career and maybe an endorsement deal or something with the insurance agency that he's going to be selling for soon. But he's not a professional quarterback for longer.
By that standard, Gary Quazo is a Hall of Famer. All right, so and I say that
that's
with great respect. Okay, and Gary Quazo would have started for the Steelers this past year.
And actually, many people that would have started for the Steelers this past year.
My friend, great to hear you. Appreciate your time as always. Look forward to talking to you soon.
Definitely. Thanks for having me, guys.
He speaks of Duck Hodges the way some speak of Jalen Hurts. Who would that some be? Back with more in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Great to have you with us today. Sal Palantonio on the show tomorrow. Also, we'll hear from Phil Troutwine, Penn State's new offensive line coach tomorrow. Another fun day coming up. Our thanks to Neal Coolong for joining us today. Mike Conti for joining us today. And Chris Mack. Another fun show. Mack, great job as always, despite the issues that you have with the Eagles draft. I'm concerned, Matt. This is going to happen right up until Jalen Hurts scores his first touchdown, and then you sprain an ankle jumping on the bandwagon.